My name is Steven Sain. I'm one of the radiation oncologists, like my colleague Dr. Hong, who just gave a talk on primary prostate radiation therapy. My talk's going to be more focused on what happens, unfortunately, to some men who go through either radiation or surgery and their PSA comes back. And how do we approach that? So, you know, kind of some of the goals of today's talk will be what we call it, how do we define a PSA recurrence? What does it mean when a PSA comes back, right? We're going to review what risk factors might increase that chance from recurring. And we'll kind of go through pretty much my more tailored approach to clinical and imaging evaluation. I won't talk too much about PETs here, just that I want to steal Dr. Hope's thunder, who's coming after me here. And then we'll talk about kind of various clinical scenarios and how I kind of think about treatment options for these patients, right? So what is PSA failure, right? Or recurrence? It's also known as biochemical failure. Just depends on what you had, right? As we kind of had from Dr. Washington, Cooperberg, and Carroll, you know, after surgery, your PSA should drop to zero. So the typical definition of a PSA recurrence is a PSA that's 0.2 and then a secondary rise. Now, as our ability to detect PSA has gotten better, right, ultra-sensitive PSA, sometimes people might pull the trigger early of calling something recurrent, especially in the setting of like more aggressive features, which I'll describe in a minute. Radiation is different, right? And then some people often ask me why. It's probably just because when we radiate an entire prostate gland, some of the normal prostate tissue sticks around. And so what we do is we kind of get your lowest value throughout after treatment surveillance. And then if it goes above 2, so the nadir plus 2, we call this recurrence. But not all recurrences are real. So for example, often patients who get brachytherapy, which Dr. Hong talked about, these patients can have a bounce. And it typically happens around 18 months. And this kind of goes up and it goes back down. So, you know, with new imaging, sometimes we pull this trigger even earlier, right? These definitions were made in the era without PSMA PET imaging. What are risk factors for recurrence, right? And some of these are shared by both surgery and radiation. So for example, I have some MRI features and I think we did, Dr. Carroll did a really nice job of showing this. So for example, this is an MRI of someone's prostate that I kind of just traced in red. You can see here on this side, there's a nice kind of clear delineation of the prostate border, but not on this side, right? It's kind of lumpy and bumpy. And so we call extra prostatic extension, meaning this has not left the prostate region, it's just extending from it, right? And these regions tend to like to come back. Vice versa, or you know, similarly, you have something called seminal vesicle invasion, right? And so during surgery, the surgeon will take out the seminal vesicle, we also treat it, but these are more signifiers of really aggressive disease biology, right? This next one is more of a surgical, obviously, risk factor. So what I'm trying to show here, and it's, don't take this as a prostatectomy, this is definitely not that, but just the concept of what a positive margin is, right? So sometimes when our surgical colleagues go in, the ideal situation is in situation A, where their cancer is surrounded by normal tissue, we call this a negative margin. And then we have scenario B, which does happen microscopically, of course, we're talking about millimeters, where unfortunately at the edge of the specimen, this is where we get our pathology colleagues, really, that's why they're so essential. They know that there's tumor on the edge of the specimen, meaning that on the other side, there's probably cancer as well. Well, this increases the risk of the cancer growing over a period, maybe years, months, who knows. This next one is about the Gleason pattern. I know Dr. Ding did an amazing job describing what Gleason scores are, so I won't go into that. But of course, the higher your score, the more aggressive cancer looks on the microscope, the more likely it's going to come back, right? And then the last one I discuss is the PSA limbo, right? So how low can you go? So after radiation, I always tell patients, the lower the better, right? If they get to 0.2, wonderful, right? If they get to 0, great. Same thing with surgery, obviously. We want to be undetectable. What do we do when this happens, right? So how do we take the evaluation approach? Well, first thing I look at is like your life expectancy, right? Because some of my treatments might not benefit you if you're not going to live more than 10 years. Just to give you an example, I think Dr. Small and Dr. Agarwal kind of mentioned the fitting the Mack truck, right, into the curves of separation for benefit. Well, sometimes if you're only going to live 5 years because you have really bad diabetes or multiple heart attacks, stroke, or maybe you're 89, well, I'm not as excited about being overly aggressive. But it's also involved with like patient goals, right? How much does a patient want to be aggressive? And we kind of have this, I usually give patients a spectrum of options, like this is what you can do, and this is what you can do to do everything, right? And then we just kind of go through the pros and cons of each option. I usually, especially after surgery, we'll talk about patients' urinary and bowel function, especially urinary. I do not like rating patients who have urinary incontinence if they need it after surgery, because I do tell them it tends to hang around for life. It's not something I take a lot of pleasure in. So I really reinforce the Kegels. I try to see if we can watch their PSAs, and I'll touch that a point a little bit later, and their erectile function. I do say, unfortunately, if you have some sort of erectile function after surgery and I do have to radiate you, the chances of you keeping it are not very high. But I do emphasize, for example, this is what Cialis and Viagra are for, to help you kind of preserve, at least have an attempt to preserve that. Then we go into more of the cancer characteristics, right? So for example, I get their PSA, their testosterone. I calculate a PSA doubling time. Typically, if your PSA is doubling faster than 12 months, I get a little worried. That's something a little more aggressive, right? We get a PET scan. Of course, again, I'm not going to go too much into that because we have a lecture coming up in a minute about that. But essentially, PET scans have been great about finding what I call like microscopic disease, or I would say not microscopic, but smaller amounts of disease that were not traditionally found on regular imaging. That's what I'm trying to show here in that top diagram with the little arrow that's pretty tiny, probably would have been missed on more regular imaging. And then for patients who had a positive margin, I do like to either get an MRI or I'll ask my urologist to do a transrectal ultrasound to look for local recurrence. They're both really great. And I say that in the context of, you can see around the MRI, I kind of circled it there in red. They did an MRI and they said, yeah, this area looks concerning that there's some cancer still left in the surgical bed where the surgery was done. And it does change my management for radiation as well, right? And then we always want a biopsy to confirm that. There we go. So let's kind of just go through kind of typical scenarios. So for example, this is a patient who has surgery. He's pretty healthy. I think he's going to live for many, many years. At the time of his PSA failure, let's say it was low. I mean, by low, I mean kind of consistent with AUA guidelines, something less than 0.5, 0.2, 0.3 is what I typically see because our urologists are pretty great about getting them back in. I ask about their continence, of course. If it's good, then I'll usually proceed forward with radiation therapy to their surgical bed, right? And then it just depends on sometimes how I modify this. Again, my own personal practice, but if, for example, your PSA is above 0.4, I get a little bit worried about the risk of, you know, this cancer going to your lymph nodes in the future. So I'll treat them prophylactically with whole pelvic radiation. If your PSA is above 0.6, some data would suggest that there's a benefit of adding androgen deprivation to reduce the risk of developing metastatic disease. But I don't just purely use your PSA, of course, because as we've seen, PSA is not entirely reflective of disease biology. But sometimes like your Gleason score might make me think one way or the other, whether you had aggressive features, seminal vesicle involvement, extra prostatic extension, a short PSA doubling time that I referred to before. And then it was kind of touched upon, deciphers, arterias, really at this point, more likely deciphers, can sometimes suggest that you would benefit from either ADT or not doing ADT. Some patients ask, would I offer salvage radiation, right? So what we call this, for patients who have a PSA of less than 0.2, it's a very complex discussion. If you're incontinent, probably not. Definitely not, actually, at least in my personal practice. That's what kind of bullet point three is saying there from the AUA guidelines, that, you know, if you have a detectable PSA, even if it's less than 0.2, but you have some high-risk features, it's not unreasonable to do that. I really do push for them to get continence first. And then on the flip side, how about post-PSA monitoring, right? And especially in the era of PSMA PETs, is there an approach where we can kind of watch the PSA a little bit longer than we typically would, see if we can catch something on PET? The answer is, it's a very nuanced discussion, probably, but we don't know that probably to the future. So I think it's just plugging into your rad onc and your local urologist or here at UCSF early is always a good idea to have that discussion. Very data-driven. I just wanted to show what a radiation plan looks like in the post-surgical setting. I think Dr. Hong did a great job of showing it in the upfront setting. And the point here is like the area in red is kind of the high dose radiation zone where we kind of boost the surgical bed for any kind of what we think is microscopic disease, right? And then this is an example where I'm treating someone's pelvic lymph nodes. That's what the kind of blue color is. And this is a dose colored gram. So hotter is red, lighter is blue, just to give you a sense of what that is. And we do a pretty nice job of, you know, trying to spare as much rectum as possible, even though the rectum will still get some radiation, of course. And same thing with the bladder, right? And you kind of see if you like squint and believe it, that's maybe where your prostate used to be, right? That's kind of how I describe it to patients. And to Dr. Hong's point, this is why the comfortably full bladder is so important, because the more you can fill your bladder, at least comfortably, I always emphasize that part, the less of the totality of it will get radiation. Here are some other scenarios I kind of commonly see. Again, healthy gentleman, but this time there is a positive lymph node in the pelvis on PET or maybe, you know, post-operative MRI. Well, this person will get the, what I call the full Monty, right? Whole pelvic radiation, prostate bed radiotherapy. you know, with androgen deprivation, sometimes for 2 years, actually typically. And then with, as Dr. Small mentioned, a secondary drug that will kind of block testosterone through a different pathway, right? Scenario three, this is the one that I sometimes think about. Guys maybe don't have more than 5 to 10 years to live, but they do have a positive lymph node. Sometimes we can do SBRT just to the lymph node. The reason I don't default to that is because those patients tend to have a lymph node pop up shortly after in a different location. So you might be playing a little whack-a-mole, but I tell the patients that, right? So they're kind of mentally prepared. Or if they've had, by any coincidence, prior pelvic radiation therapy for any reason, maybe they had rectal cancer, who knows, right? And then I will actually just offer SBRT. And then the last scenario will be discussed by Dr. Hong is, what do you do when the cancer's gone to the bone? How about after radiation, right? And I think this is a nice segue because we've talked about all these treatment options. So for example, if you have just purely local recurrence, it's not a common phenomenon just to have local recurrence alone, but I will discuss with them brachytherapy, which we do here at UCSF. You know, it's called the HDR method, where they put wires in to the area of recurrence. They'll kind of just boost that area with radiation, pull out the wires, and you're pretty much done after two sessions, right? Then we have focal therapies with Dr. Nguyen, HIFU, cryo. And actually, I just sent a patient yesterday for this exact reason. The recurrence after radiation was Gleason 3+3, probably a good candidate, focal, right to where Dr. Nguyen can go in there and zap it, right? Then we have SBRT. I don't do this as common. The data suggests that it's probably fine and safe to do and probably efficacious. It's just that usually the focal therapy has less toxicity. So elicited re-irradiation, right? And then finally, a salvage prostatectomy, which, you know, it's not a urologist's dream because the tissues are much more like fireable and they're like kind of not as going to heal as well because they're scar tissue from radiation that forms over a period of years, right? Scenario two, we talk about pelvic lymph node positive patients. So let's say the prostate looks good, but there's a positive lymph node. Similar to my last discussion, could be whole pelvic radiation, SBRT, and then given with hormone therapy. There we go. So in short, you know, I thought we did a nice job of talking about what PSA recurrence is, just depending on your clinical scenario. Risk factors are for PSA recurrence, no matter whether you do surgery or radiation, are fairly similar about kind of the grade, the nearby local invasion, whether it's your seminal vesicle, extra prostatic extension, your lowest PSA after treatment. And then it's really complicated. You know, it's funny. I gave Dr. Washington a hard time. He said, oh, you know, post-operative radiation is, you know, fairly straightforward. And I said, Sam, it's really not that straightforward, but it's a very complex discussion that actually I feel lucky to have with our urologists here. And we usually come to a consensus before I start treatment, right? And then, you know, my treatment personally just depends on the patient's goals, their life expectancy, what I see on their imaging, and having a goals of care discussion. But with that, I'll say thank you for your time, and I appreciate your attention.